just to let you know, and this is not uncommon because a lot of people don't understand what franchising is. So when I talk about franchising, people think it's only burgers or it's only Chick-fil-A. So a lot of people assume that, well, if it's related to franchising, I don't want to do it. I don't want to learn about it because I know I don't want to do food. So what I'm really talking about today is franchising as a way to think about organizing a business. It's really what we like to affectionately call business in a box. But what I'm going to talk about myself, and we're going to go into a couple of different things, but I call this session How to Find a Business with a Support System, because that's really what a franchise is. It's about a support system. So here is me. I am Cindy Rayfield, and I forgot my name tag today, so my apologies. I'm a franchise consultant with FranNet, and I'm a business owner. I've been a business owner for many years. I work exclusively out of the Colorado, Wyoming, and Montana marketplaces. So FranNet's a national company. There's about 100 of people just like me all over the United States, and we are a franchise ourselves, so we actually do what we teach people about. But I've been with FranNet for about 8 years, almost 9 years now at this point. But I've been a business owner in a variety of different businesses for the past 15 years. And I've come from the corporate background. I've got a corporate background in marketing, advertising, banking, telecommunications, a lot of very general things. But I've also been a business owner in the franchising world. I've had my own website development business, my own copywriting business. I had a publishing business that I just recently sold. So I kind of do a lot of different things. And I think people who are entrepreneurial have that tendency to do a lot of things because we get over our fear. There's a lot of fear that comes into owning your own business, and we're going to talk about that a little bit, because I do really focus on that at the beginning, because you have to get your head around it. You have to really understand what owning a business is, whether it's a franchise or a startup or buying somebody else's business. I did grow up here in Colorado Springs, and I spent the first 18 years of my life here, and then I moved to Denver. I went to school up there, met my husband, and so that's where I live currently. But I drive all over the state of Colorado. I drive up into Montana and Wyoming, and I put people in business in all sorts of different marketplaces. So I love what I do. This is very fascinating to me. I love that I get to learn about so many different businesses and so many different industries. And I try to share that with people when I'm telling them about franchising, because it's not just food. So we'll talk a little bit about that as we get closer to it. So again, what FranNet is, it's an international franchise consulting firm. There's over 90 consultants in North America, and we actually have some in Europe as well. So we are an international company. We have worked with the Small Business Administration since 1987. So we've been around a long time, really since the beginning when franchising really started to take off in the United States. So we have a strong history, a strong track record. We also work with the Small Business Development Centers and the local SCORE offices, providing support to people who want to ask about franchising. I'm actually a SCORE counselor as well, and I'm certified to teach with the Small Business Development Center, so I've done some consulting with the Small Business Development Center also. I do go on to military bases. I actually, because Colorado is full of military bases, I'm actually teaching at the Air Force Academy, Peterson, and then there's a couple of other bases that I haven't been teaching at yet. But I do probably two or three times a month I'm here in Colorado Springs doing some form of education with military. And I've assisted, it says here, assisted thousands of people with franchise ownership. I personally have not put thousands of people in business, but I've probably done 100 people in the 8 years that I've been here. So, but over time, FranNet has put thousands of people in business, and we really do this at no cost to people. We get a referral fee. We are franchise headhunters. That's pretty much what we do. And so we get a referral fee when we place people into a business. So this is the process that we put people through is really one of those things where there's no cost involved, which you get to learn a lot in the process. And I like to say you have a good time. You get to learn about something fun and exciting and kind of get your juices flowing. Sometimes people buy businesses and sometimes they don't. It's all about whether my job is to get you to a yes or a no. That's really what I do. Oh, topics for discussion today. We're going to talk about why business ownership can be attractive, some of the roadblocks to success, some of the ambushes, and just so you know, your handouts are going to be slightly different from this one because I added a couple of slides in here. So if you want the full thing, if you like what I had to say on a couple of those slides, let me know. We're going to talk about what franchising is, franchise ownership versus independent ownership, and employment dollars. What that really looks like. So if you're really thinking about business ownership and you want to compare it dollar to dollar for what you might be making as an employee, we're going to talk a little bit about that so you can compare it. We're going to talk about some benefits to veterans and the research process. So I always ask everybody, if you knew you could be a successful business owner, would you rather work for someone else? I see your head shaking. I mean, you're in this room for a reason. And I find that to be true. Typically, when I have my seminars, it's not a full room because most people are like, no, I think I just want to go get a job. It's easier to get a job. It's comfortable to get a job. But if you're anything like me, having a job doesn't make sense because I'm not a good employee. I don't want to work for someone else. I want to work for me. I want to set the ground rules. And in franchising, it's kind of a hybrid between being able to run your own business, but you still operate within some parameters, some of the guardrails. So for people who are thinking, I want to be in business, but I'm not sure, franchising might be a really good resource for them to take a look at. Because starting your own business can be scary, and there's a lot of risk involved. There is risk in owning business no matter what. Business is risk for reward. And I tell people that up front, they have to be prepared for that. But the nice thing about franchising is you can actually do the research to determine if it's going to be a good fit. But again, most people go back and work for someone else. And that comes down to mostly these points right here, the four that are on this slide. Risk, success is not guaranteed, so there is some risk. Money is a big factor in this. Businesses can start a lot of money or can cost a lot of money to start and get up to speed. But not always. There are some businesses out there where it doesn't cost a lot of money. And I really take people through that process. If their budget doesn't allow them to buy a really high investment franchise, then let's talk about some that are considered low cost. But even at that, it still may be out of their reach, but we talk about maybe now is not the time, but perhaps down the road. So money can be a factor in this. Skills. People really do feel that running a business takes particular skills and talent. And the reality is that's not always the case. If you come prepared with a good set of business skills, just general knowledge about the business community, it doesn't always take those specialty skills. I'm not a rocket scientist, I'm not a brain surgeon, but I am a good business owner, and that's how most of my business owner friends usually are. And fear of failure is a big one. Just fear of not being successful. It's a big factor for people. And I always tell people this, these are kind of my guidelines for dealing with the fear of failure. You're gonna feel fearful, and it's normal. You're going to feel that if you're looking at a business, if you're looking at a new job, if you're looking at anything, if you've been laid off, if you've been transitioned out of something, there's going to be a fear factor and you have to be able to overcome that. So I tell people when they're looking at businesses, feel the fear. It's okay. You're going to get those butterflies in your stomach, and it's okay to feel that. So you need to be able to manage and reduce it. And by doing research and making fact-based decisions and not emotion-based decisions can also be very helpful in dealing with the fear. A lot of times people will fall in love with a business, especially if they've already been doing some research before they come to me. They've already fallen in love with something like Chick-fil-A or something like that, because I get questions about Chick-fil-A quite often. And the reality is what we tell people, don't fall in love with your business before you've done the research. Do more research. Look at just the facts, and certainly, I want you to fall in love with your business at the end, but at the end of the process, stay in fact-finding mode, not decision mode during this entire process. Minimizing the leap of faith, really, that's research. Research is going to help you minimize that leap of faith. You're never going to get to 100% assurance of anything that you look at. You're never going to know 100% if this is the right decision. But if you can get to 80 or 90%, then that may be the right decision for you to make. So we're trying to help you get as far as possible as you can, but there is going to be a small leap of faith, and you have to be able to do that. You have to be able to pull the trigger. And sometimes people aren't willing to pull the trigger, and that's okay. Then they need to go back and find a job, and that's perfectly fine too. That makes good sense for a lot of people to do that. Again, allowing their fear of their fear and emotion to drive decisions. We want to avoid that. Making judgments based on perceptions and uneducated opinions. This happens all too frequently, like the assumption that franchising is all about food, so therefore I'm not going to look at it, when I only have, out of 125 different franchise concepts, I have about six of them that are focused on food. And they're not the ones that you're thinking of. So they're not the McDonald's, they're not the Chick-fil-A, they're not the KFC. They're ones that are different, unique, new to the marketplace, probably ones that you haven't heard of before. And so we want people to keep an open mind, because sometimes there's something that's gonna fit your personality that you may not have thought of, and we want you to be open to that. Nobody ever goes in thinking, well, I take myself as an example. I didn't wake up one day and say, I want to be a franchise consultant. Wow, it sounds really cool. Usually most people have this dream when they're kids of being a firefighter or a ballerina or an astronaut. But really what drives me is the passion for working with people, for being in front of people, for learning something new, for being inspired by business ownership. Those are the things that really drive me. And so what I want people to avoid doing is making assumptions like, a cleaning business isn't for me, when you don't really know until you've started taking a look at the entire business. So I do ask people to keep an open mind. That kind of leads me to this very last one. Is this what I think, or is it what I know? Because most people, what they think is involved in a certain business really is not accurate. It's not what they know. When I'm showing people certain businesses, I'm showing it to them for a reason, because it fits their personality and their profile. And I want people to understand that there's certain aspects of this business that fit you, and you need to learn more. You need to uncover why that is. One of the things for managing emotional ups and downs, this is something that I threw in because I thought it would be interesting. Now, this is not going to be in your packet. These next two slides, yeah, I know, I see you back there flipping through it. Going, where is this one? These next two slides are not in the packet, but this has been very helpful for a lot of my clients, and it's been helpful for me. What a lot of us do when we're going through some sort of search, like a job search or a business search or something of that nature, we operate in a self-sabotage cycle. That's kind of our mode of operation always. We kind of self-sabotage ourselves, and we do it, we don't mean to do it, but this is really the cycle that we go through. Stage one is excitement. Oh, great, I'm learning something new, I'm gonna find a new job, things are gonna be different, my world is gonna be different. We're out there really kind of trying to strike up something new. We have that really emotional excitement. It's kind of like falling in love, like you found a boyfriend or a new girlfriend. You're excited about that. Stage two is that initial commitment stage where we're like, okay, I'm into this. I'm doing the research. I'm doing what I need to do. I'm still focused. I'm still engaged. I'm still committed. Stage three is where the drift comes in, and that's where the bloom starts to come off the rose. You start seeing, this isn't exactly what I thought. I'm still interested, but I'm not as excited as I was before. Stage three is a critical point, because if we recognize that we're in that stage, we can actually do something about it. But we don't. Most people go into stage four, which is self-sabotage, which is when we start talking ourselves out of it. We start talking ourselves out of a decision. We start thinking, well, you know, it's probably not going to work anyway, so let's just abandon it. And this is where I see people leaving the franchise research process or the process where they're looking for a business. This is where they leave. Number five is that shiny new object syndrome. Something else has entered the picture that's now caught their attention, and we're moving on to something else. And I can picture myself going through these phases, and you can probably picture yourself going through these phases at some point in your life as well. Shiny new object syndrome is a rampant disease that is running through our society right now. And with technology, with our phones, with our computers, it just rules the roost right now. So it's something that I want people to bring attention, I want to bring attention to that. Stage six is regret, when we kind of go back and go, gosh, you know, if I had done that business, I would have been in business now for a year. But here I am, kind of back to square one, starting all over again. And then we start the self-sabotage cycle again. So I bring this up because I want people to stop this self-sabotage cycle, and I want to break the cycle. So this is the key. When we get into stage one and stage two, recognize where we are. When we get into stage three and that drift starts to come in, what I want you to think about is, okay, I see this drift coming in, I feel it, I understand it, I recognize it, I'm gonna break the cycle. I don't wanna go back in to stage four. So to break the cycle, once you start breaking the cycle, you go into stage four here where you shift into grittiness. Does anybody know what grit is? Have you heard that term? It's kind of something that people are tossing around a lot now. It's that drive, that motivation, that courage, those things that we do, even though we want to do something else, we just roll up our sleeves and get it done. So I tell people, this is the time to shift into grittiness and get it done and get through it. And I actually counsel people. I have methodologies for how to get your work done and how to work through these things and how to bring more grit into your work. So we talk about those things during the process. Stage five at this point can give you the long-term rewards, because if you can get through that stage, you can really start to see some rewards. And stage six would be satisfaction. And then that whole cycle can start all over again, where you can start really going back in and redefining decisions that you make. So this is abbreviated, and it's a whole psychological subject, but I think it really can help people to break their fear and to break that self-sabotage cycle that we see ourselves get into. So for what it's worth, if you gain nothing else from that, take that away. If you're looking for a job, if you're looking for a business, take that away and understand that, okay, by the time I get into stage three, I need to really start shifting gears and shifting into that grittiness. So now, this is where we start talking about franchising. I say how to fail at franchise because, again, these are the mistakes that people make when they're getting into franchising. They base their decisions on emotions, whether products and services are the main criteria. They choose a franchise in which they have industry experience. And I know this sounds really weird, but we don't want you to necessarily know in franchising. We don't necessarily want you to come in with some experience. Like if you're a mechanic, I don't want you to buy a Meineke, because what you'll do is you'll get under the hood and you'll work under the hood instead of going out and growing your business. If you come from the hair care industry, I don't want you buying a Supercuts or a Great Clips, because it's really easy to get behind the chair and start cutting hair, and that's not what we want. So we want to separate the role of the owner from the job, because the role of the owner is to grow the business and to grow revenue. The role of the owner is to not do the work. So we want people to understand that. And that kind of falls in with this misplaced passion. Sometimes people get caught up in a passion, and we hear this term thrown around, follow your passion and the money will come, follow what you're passionate about. And while that's true, I want you to think about all the businesses that are out there that you're thinking, well, how can somebody have a passion for cleaning? How can somebody have a passion for commercial or residential cleaning? How can somebody have a passion for cutting other people's hair? How do people have a passion for refinishing a floor or refinishing cabinets? So take that away a little bit and think about that, because I didn't necessarily have a passion for being a franchise consultant, but there's certain aspects of the business that I can be passionate about, like growing a business. There's a certain excitement in that. So a lot of times that misplaced passion will lead people down a path where they're never satisfied, because if it doesn't fulfill the passion, if you can't check the box, then they just won't do it. So we want people to be open and understand what it is that makes them passionate about something. It doesn't necessarily have to be collecting stamps or something that really kind of relates to a hobby or a passion. It's not always easy to make money on those. So, anybody in this room have this thought? Sure, I'd like to own my own business, but I think it's too risky. Yeah, I see some heads shaking back there. That's the first thing people think. Yes, again, business is risk for reward. But I want to describe a couple of things here in the perception of risk. Is working for someone else safe? In the short term, it can be true. Can you find a job in the city in which you live? That's a big challenge. I see people that come to me all the time that are having a real struggle finding jobs where they want to live. And then when they move and they find a job somewhere else, I can't even tell you how many times people get laid off within a year or two after they move to a new job, and then they're in this new city. And they've just been placed there. So it happens a lot. But what I really want people to understand is your risk over time when you have a job is greater, because the longer you're there, the more money you make and the more benefits you have and the more likely you are to get laid off. So, and it's almost like having all of your eggs in one basket, because you've got one source of income, you've got one client, and that's your employer. In business ownership, at first it can be scary, but no one can take it away from you. And the point of this slide is the longer you have it, the more clients you have, which means more money coming in from different sources. So if you lose a client, you're not losing all of your income. For me, it's more risky for me to take a job because if I lose that one job, I lose the income. If I lose a client, I can go out and get others when you own your own business. So it becomes more secure over time. I do want to list a couple of things here, some suggested reading for you. Has anybody read any of these books? E-Myth Revisited is one that kind of gets tossed around. It's a good one because it really does describe business ownership, and it doesn't really focus necessarily on franchising, but it talks about how to organize your business so it operates like a franchise, how to systematize your business, because that's what a franchise is. It's systematized. So the E-Myth Revisited uses some stories and some anecdotes to kind of get that point across. Street Smart Franchising is basically a handbook for how to look for franchising. So it's going to help you. In fact, we give it to our clients when they're working with us so that they can use it hand in hand with the process, with the research process. The Millionaire Next Door is a really good book. Anybody read that one before? Yeah. There's a couple people back there. It's really good because it talks about wealth in America. I haven't read it in a while, but I remember being fascinated by it. And the reason they call it The Millionaire Next Door is because the real millionaires don't live necessarily in the fancy houses or drive the fancy cars. They live in quaint neighborhoods where they don't display a lot of money, but they have a lot of wealth. And a lot of times, 5 out of 6 millionaires actually have done that through small business ownership. And then this very last one, I have this book out on my table out there. If you'd like one, I'm giving them away today. I'm actually a co-author of this one. So there's 15 of us that wrote chapters in this book. So I brought it today. So it's interesting. I just added this to this slide before y'all came in here because I thought I have to add that as recommended reading. So if you're interested, it kind of gives some, it's from 15 thought leaders, people in the industry. So it's interesting to look at. So what is franchising? A franchise is a license to use names and trademarks of a company. Like, think McDonald's. You're allowed to use the names and the trademarks. You're allowed to sell their products and services. You're given a license to be able to do that. And use the business systems. Those are the behind-the-scenes things that make this business really unique. So it's the model. It's the accounting system. It's the marketing system, support, operations. How do you get your clients? How do you maintain your clients? How do you operate internally? What kind of software is on the back end of this? Those are all of the things that really make, because you know, you can sell hamburgers. I can sell a hamburger just like McDonald's sells a hamburger. They just have all of this back end stuff that really makes it unique and systematized, and that's what people are buying. They're not buying the fact that you're selling a hamburger. It's the system behind it. I always tell people it's a proven system that's easily replicated with predictable results. So when I say proven, it means that other people have done it, other people have been successful in it. It doesn't mean that everybody's been successful in it, but they have a track record. Every franchise has a document called the Franchise Disclosure Document. It's very transparent. It has all the information about that franchise, total costs, lists of other franchisees. There's a bunch of information in it, and they're very transparent. So you can actually go see and research the results. Easily replicated, that means if we can do it in Colorado Springs, we can do it in San Diego, we can do it in Portland, we can do it in Miami. It should be something that can be rolled out to a variety of different markets with relative success based on the marketplace. And then again, the predictable results. You can actually go through and look at the franchise disclosure document and see what those predictable results are. So in exchange for that, you're paying an initial franchise license fee that ranges anywhere from about $25,000 to $45,000. It could cost more if you're buying multiples. So if you're buying the rights to the entire state or if you're buying 6 or more, your license fees are probably going to be less or more than that. But you get them at a discount. So again, buying in quantity, you get a discount. And then typically you're getting a 10-year license. That doesn't mean that it's not your business. That doesn't mean that you're stuck in this for 10 years. It means that for 10 years, that's how long the license goes. But during that time, you can sell the business, you can transfer the business, you can hand it down to your kids. It's yours to do with what you will. But that's what that fee covers, is the 10-year license. Also, there's ongoing royalties, typically ranging anywhere from 5% to 10% of gross revenue. A lot of times that takes the wind out of the room when I say that because it seems like a lot of money. But your royalties need to be going for things like support. which you're not going to be getting if you started your own business. If you're the entrepreneur and you start from the ground up, of course you're not paying royalties, but you kind of have to see what you can throw against the wall and what's going to stick. In franchising, you're getting training, you're getting experience, you're getting products at a discount, if that's what it means. You may be getting the back-end software system. All of those things are covered by royalties. So you should definitely, as you're doing your research, understand that your royalties are going to something, and you need to understand what those are. It should never be going into a black hole. So we call it, again, a business in a box or a system roadmap. That's really what we're looking at. We want people to understand that this is about having a path to go on, having those guardrails as you're going down the road. It doesn't mean that you don't have control of your own business. It just means you have to stay within the guardrails. So let's talk a little bit about business financial returns, a W-2 employee, some legal advantages, company earnings and personal income. Really, when you have a business, there's a couple of things that a business does for you. You can create equity in a business, so you're able to sell it and realize the benefits from that at the end. And you can also have an income at the same time. So you're creating two streams for you. So again, building equity, the value of a business is the most overlooked assessment factor in a business. It's important because it's the value of a franchise on the open market. So if you're looking at 5 years down the road selling your franchise, if you've got this thing humming and you've got cash flow coming in and it's good solid cash flow, you may be able to ask 2.5 to 5 times that cash flow as your selling price. That's reasonable. That's what people are selling their businesses for. So, for instance, if you're bringing home $100,000 in cash flow, you may be able to sell it for $250,000 to as much as $500,000. It just depends on the business, and it depends on how motivated you are to sell and how motivated a buyer might be. But the equity growth is really, you know, over the course of 5 years, to be able to sell a business like that is kind of exciting. And that's one of the factors for long-term, for retirement benefits as well. That could be your retirement. So we're going to do a little bit of math here. My friend put this together for me because I think it really describes why you might want to do a business versus being a W-2 employee. So if you're getting $100,000 in W-2 gross wages, it really is the heaviest income tax burden, and there's no resale value to it. You can't sell your job. It'd be great if we could, but there's no equity in your job. So that $100,000 net cash flow to an independent business owner, it can be sheltered income. This is if you have your own business. The income from it is sheltered. The resale value of it, again, is 1 to 2 times net cash flow. That's $100,000 to $200,000. This is if you were starting up your own business. It's got limited financing, and it's dependent on owner financing. And really what I mean by that, if you're starting up your own business from scratch, there are not a lot of options out there for you to get financing up front, because there aren't any banks that are going to lend to new concepts. They just don't. They want you to have some sort of track record, some sort of experience. If you're buying somebody else's business, at least it has a track record, you're more likely to get funding for that rather than doing a startup on your own. So it's going to depend on you to pull the money out of your pocket or to find the financing to open this business. And again, without the systems behind it, unless you've really got this system documented, you may not be able to see the equity that you could in another type of business. So $100,000 net cash flow to a franchise owner. Again, the income that you're making is sheltered. You've got the resale value of 2.5 to 5 times. I haven't seen 6 times cash flow. I've seen 2.5 to 5 times cash flow as the selling point, which can equate to $200,000 to $600,000 on that $100,000 net cash flow. You do get some SBA guaranteed loans, and there's additional financing options that you're not going to find in a startup business. The reason for that is there's something called the franchise registry, and there's a lot of franchises. There's hundreds of franchises on the franchise registry. The franchise registry is what banks use to actually determine if they can fund a franchise. Now, that doesn't mean if your franchise is not on the registry that you won't get funding, but it gives your bank a little bit more leverage to be able to fund your business. And franchises are actually fundable to the tune of about 75 to 80%. By a bank. So you do have to come to the table with some money in your pocket, probably the amount of the franchise license fee that I talked about early on, but everything else, your build out, your products, your services, all of those things can be financed. You have to be able to get a loan. I mean, it's just like anything else. You have to be able to qualify for the loan, but you can get funding for it, which is kind of appealing to a lot of people. And really, it's because of that proven business model. Because others have done it before, the bank is more willing to lend toward that. Again, it's never 100%. You do have to come to the table with cash to be able to buy a certain amount of it. It's like buying your house. You have to have money down, that kind of thing. So same thing with the business. Just so that you all know, there are over 2,500 veteran franchise owners since 2002. This is according to an IFA survey. IFA is the International Franchise Association, so it's like our large association for the franchise industry. You can find a lot of information on franchising on their website. So if you're curious, go to franchise.org. Probably more information than you will ever be able to take in. I'd like to talk a little bit about why franchises like veteran business owners. Veterans know how to follow a system and they know how to execute. That's really what they're good at. So franchisors really like that. They have leadership skills, they have the ability to follow a system, the determination, and then again, they can execute a plan. Just give them a plan of action and they can execute it. That's what a franchise is. So they do really like veteran business owners. The one challenge that I have is helping vets to overcome the fear factor, because that really does come into play when I'm working with a lot of vets. So understand that if you do decide to engage with me or work with anybody in the franchise industry, we're going to want to ask you a lot of questions about, will you be able to do this? There's certain things you need to know, like your insurance is not going to be covered. Like the military was covering your insurance before. It's not going to happen now. So there's a lot of things that you learn as you go through it, but there's resources to help you. But franchisors really do like vets, and they look specifically for them. There's a program called VetFran, and it allows the franchisors that participate in it to offer discounts to vets. So, and you guys all probably know this, because people who are part of veteran families know that if it isn't displayed, that there's a discount somewhere, you ask for it. And that's kind of how you've been brought up. The same thing with franchising. Even if it's not displayed, if it's not written down somewhere, ask if they give a veteran discount. Because chances are they might. And they might take a pretty good portion of money off of the franchise license fee, or they might offer a discount in other ways, such as covering your expenses for training, or giving you a discount, or helping you get your inventory lined up. So there's a lot of things out there that you just have to ask. But for those businesses, or for those franchises that participate in VetFran, they're very proud of that, and they'll actually let you know, which is why when I work with a vet, I want to ask that question. Are you a vet, number one? And if you are, we're going to make sure that the franchisor knows that up front so they can talk to you about discounts at the very beginning. And they're all different. It's not like some one thing across the board, so it's all different, but they can go into detail with you about what those discounts are. Let's talk a little bit about the cost of a franchise. Sometimes this worries people a little bit, because they start thinking, they see this under $50,000, and people go, $50,000 for a business, it seems like a lot of money. But if you take a look, remember the slide where I showed you the franchise license fee alone can range from anywhere from $25,000 to $45,000. A $50,000 franchise then is not that expensive if most of that goes to cover your license. So there are franchises out there that may be minimal cost beyond the franchise license fee. Especially if you have a home office, you can keep your expenses down if you're using your personal vehicle, or if you don't need to get a special vehicle, maybe you need a computer, maybe you need some material, maybe you need to do some marketing, but you're keeping your costs pretty low. Now it ranges all the way up to over $500,000. So I have franchises that range from $50,000 to $1 million. And it really just depends on the franchise. It also depends on factors like how many you want to buy. I have a gentleman right now looking at a franchise. An individual unit costs about $400,000, but he wants to buy a three-pack. Now, that doesn't mean that he's going to operate all three of them, get all three of them up at the same time, but he's going to start with the first one and then go to the second and go to the third. So he's buying the licenses up front for the discount, with the plan of action to open them in various communities as he grows. Let me see, I want to go back to this because I do want to make sure that we understand what a franchise investment covers. It's not just the franchise license fee, but it covers everything top to bottom. So when the franchisor tells you the total initial investment, which is going to be listed in the franchise disclosure document, it's going to mean everything, soup to nuts, from your franchise license fee, your marketing that you're going to need for the first 4 to 6 months to get off the ground, any working capital that you need in the bank to cover employee salaries or to cover rent for the first few months, because you're not making money right out of the gate. So you need to have a little bit of padding to come into the business until you're starting to make money to cover those expenses. But in the beginning, you're going to know from the franchisor how much this investment is, and line item by line item what all of those expenses cover. So at the end, you go, okay, I can see that this particular franchise, a retail franchise in the luxury spa arena, is going to cost $400,000. There's equipment, there's employees, there's the build out, there's the whole persona, there's the feel. You may be having to spend $2,500, $3,000 a month in marketing to get off the ground, and it may be more expensive in the early stages. So it'll be really easy to see what that initial investment covers and what each of those items are going for. They're going to be very clear with you on that. Sources of capital. So when people start coming to me and they start saying, well, where do people get the money to buy this business and how do I do that? Sometimes it comes from personal savings. A lot of times that initial franchise license fee may come from some sort of personal savings account or stocks or something of that nature. People also use their IRA 401k capitalization strategy. This is popular, and this was very popular during 2008-2009 when there were no banks giving any loans whatsoever, but people were still buying business. They were doing that by using their IRAs to do that. Now, I will tell you, it's a great program. I don't do it, I actually refer people out. In fact, I don't do any of the financing. I refer all of it out to other people. So, it's an option for some people. For some people, it's not an option at all. This wouldn't be a consideration for them. But for some people, this is how they get into business. Home equity line of credit, that's another way that people do that. Lines of credit that they can get from banks, they may have a line of credit on their own. SBA Veteran Loan Advantage Program. There are some vet loans out there that may give special assistance to veterans. You still have to be able to qualify for the loan, but it is something that there may be some special incentive, or you might get a lower rate, or they might just expedite the loan a little bit more. Maybe there's less paperwork to fill out. I always tell people to check with their local bank to be able to do that. There's third-party lenders, leasing companies. Some franchisors actually work with leasing companies within their organization or lenders, so they're able to help you get some financing. I wouldn't expect that. Most of the time, you need to come to the table with your financing already in place, but sometimes the franchisors will have special offerings with banks. Friends, relatives, or partners. Yes, I do on occasion get people who buy a business because their father decided to go into partnership with them, or a parent came into play, or a sister, a brother, a family member. So that does happen. And then again, the VetFran program that I talked about a couple slides ago is another great way. It's not necessarily financing, but it can certainly give you some discounts. Your financial preparation. These are things that you need to think about when going into business. You need to determine your monthly household expenses, because that's one thing that the franchisor is going to ask you. What they don't want you to do is to lose your home or not be able to eat because you're buying this business. So that's why they have minimum net worth requirements. What we do when I work with clients, I ask them to list their assets, their liabilities. We subtract the liabilities from the assets. It gives us our net worth. That net worth is going to be important. And it doesn't mean that sometimes people will withhold information from me. And it doesn't mean anything if they do or if they don't. But if your net worth is lower, you may not have the options that you have with a higher net worth. So I tell people, bring it all to the table, have your net worth high so that you have more choices. It doesn't mean we're going to spend every penny that you have, because I totally advise against that. You don't want to put all your chips on the table. I will have people that will come to me and they may have a lower net worth in the $100,000 range. And while I might be able to find a franchise for them, the choices are going to be less. And they're putting everything in. They're putting all their chips on the table. And I don't ever want somebody to do that. It's just not a wise thing to do. Some veterans can live on a military pension as their business ramps up. So I do work with people that have some sort of military pension that comes in on a regular basis. So we do tell people to, if they do have some sort of military pension, there's a couple of things that come into play with a military pension. First of all, if you have money coming in, the bank is more likely to lend to you. So it looks really good if you had that pension coming in, because it just means another line of revenue. It means that the bank feels like they're gonna be able to get their monthly payment. So it looks really good to banks to have that. Sometimes people have it in their savings account. That could be what their savings is. Some people will take part of it from an IRA. Just because you use your IRA doesn't mean you have to use every little bit of it. So there are people that will use the IRA for funding the franchise license fee, and then they'll use bank funding for the rest of it. So that's one way of doing it. Some people use equity that they have in a home. I've had a guy that he couldn't pull the liquid capital together, but then he got a small inheritance, and that's what he used to be able to buy the business. So it happens that way as well. But they are looking for liquid capital only because when you're ready to execute, you don't want to be waiting 60 days for a loan to go through. So they're wanting you to have that liquid capital on hand so that when you're ready to sign the agreement, you can write the check for the franchise license fee. And keep in mind that you're only paying to the franchisor the franchise license fee. Everything else, all of that build out, all of the money you need to have for employees, all of that, it comes from you. So that's gonna be in your bank account ready to pay other people. That doesn't get paid to the franchisor. So when they're talking about the initial franchise investment of $400,000, the franchisor is maybe only getting $45,000 to $50,000 of that. And then they're helping you do the rest. And then the rest, they get paid by royalties, where they're gonna be seeing the benefit of you being in business is as you are successful, your royalty amount is going to grow. So that's how they make their revenue over time. Establish your investment level, both cash and collateral for financing, which we've talked about. You are gonna need money for personal living expenses on top of your business startup costs. Typically anywhere from 6 to 12 months of working capital. If you have a working spouse, that's really good too. So military pension, working spouse, those things are very appealing to a bank because it means you're not gonna lose your house or starve in the process. Again, that's my very last point here on this slide. A couple of things about return on investment. There's no automatic correlation between the cost of a franchise and the profit that it can return. What that means is if you buy a $50,000 franchise, it doesn't mean that you're not going to make as much money as you would if you have a $300,000 franchise. It means that you're gonna have to grow that business, but it really means that up front you didn't have the overhead that you might have in a $300,000 business because you didn't have to have the location, you didn't have to have the same number of employees, all of those things. So you can actually see a return on investment in some cases sooner with the lower cost franchises versus something that's gonna cost you a lot more. But for people who are bigger players, they may want to go all in. They may want to buy that big fancy spa, which is, I'm selling a lot of those right now because it's nice, it feels good. Husbands and wives can run them together. And then as the business grows, yes, they're gonna see a nice return over time, but it's gonna take them longer to see that return because of their expense up front. So questions, what are my choices and how do I get started? These are typically the areas that I work in, although I have franchises in all kinds of different areas. And you'll note if you start looking for franchising, again, my role as a franchise consultant is to help people find franchises. There's no cost up front, but it doesn't mean that anybody has to work with a franchise consultant. Some people will do this on their own. So I think it's harder, but there's people like me. I have competitors that do this. A lot of people didn't even realize that there's people out there that actually do this type of business. But what we do is we're able to bring to the table some franchises that you might not find on the internet or things that you would probably have to dig for to find. So choices, food. Everybody eats, so of course food is always in there. And we see food, we see the signs, so we see it as we walk down the street or as we drive down the street, so that's what we know, that's what we're familiar with. That's why everybody thinks burgers when they think of franchising, or Chick-fil-A. Automotive. Automotive's big right now. I've got a lot of automotive franchises. Meineke, Maaco, Honest One, Amco, a lot of those that you're familiar with. retail businesses. I keep mentioning the spa business just because I've got clients working on that right now. But anything in retail, in fact, if you walked into a retail store in the mall, chances are it might be a franchise. So you never know. Business services, that would include things like sign manufacturing companies for businesses that need signs, digital marketing franchises, sales and leadership training franchises. So there's a whole bunch of them out there that really focus on businesses. So the businesses are their clients, not the consumers. And I've got a whole host of those. But we don't see those. We don't need those as consumers. So we typically don't recognize those. It's just not something we think of. And then home and personal services. So businesses like residential cleaning, home repairs, mold remediation, fire remediation, all of those things that senior care services, children's services, education, pet care services, all of those fall under that home and personal services category. And we have quite a few of those as well. High growth trends, convenience services, anything that we can do to make people's lives easier, those tend to do really well. Aging population, senior care, it's the one segment of the population that's going to continue to grow over the next 20 years. Children's education, big population of children coming up right now, replacing the baby boomers. So we want our kids to have a really great education. We want them to do really great on college entrance exams. So there's tutoring programs out there. There's children's edutainment is what a lot of it's called. So they can actually do some things that are entertaining and educational as well. So there's a few of those as well. Outsourced business services like the sign manufacturing or printing and marketing services. Light manufacturing, yes, they do have some manufacturing businesses. Master franchises, multi-unit opportunities, meaning you may buy the rights to the entire state of Colorado and become your own mini franchisor and sell franchises to people underneath you. Or you may want to run six franchises, six locations. That's a multi-unit operator. Low-cost business-to-business, that would be the sales training, that would be the digital marketing services. I have quite a few of those that run in that $50,000 to $75,000 range. And then some unique retail experiential services, businesses. People are kind of into doing things like going out and solving mysteries. I don't have one of those franchises right now, but I'm noticing a trend in people wanting to do experiences. And it won't be long before there's franchises that start popping up. Has anybody seen, it was a show on TV where they all went to a clue room, they call it a clue room, and they solve clues to get out of the room. It's kind of big right now. There's a lot of them coming into the market. So it's very entertainment oriented. So I'm seeing those. And somebody mentioned a rock climbing franchise. So there's a lot of things popping up that people want to experience. So I'm seeing a few of those things. Growth strategies, we talked a little bit about single location, single territory. That's where a lot of people think about when they first start out. Sometimes people come out of it thinking, okay, I'll buy three pack. That's the multi-unit. Area developer, sub-franchising, the master regional model, which I talked about, where you're buying the rights to the entire state and selling small franchises underneath. So what we tell people to do, build your business model first and really know what your must-haves are in a business and what your nice-to-haves are, because there's a difference. Your must-have might mean never working on Sundays. That's great. Let's put that in the must-have columns. Your nice-to-haves might be working with few employees. Maybe there's a business that you're going to have more employees than you actually wanted, but you're okay with that. So that may be your entry strategy. Understand what it is that you want in a business, if you want to work out of your home office, or if you want to work out of a small executive suite, or if you want to work out of a retail location. Understand where you want to work, understand how you want to work, and those are some of the things that I help people walk through, because people don't always think about that until you start asking the question. So we start with an entry strategy. That's where we help you build the business model. Long-term strategy, how do you want to grow this thing? Do you want to start with one? Maybe you want to start with three. And then what's your exit strategy down the road? Because franchising can be an ideal step between what the people consider that pre-retirement and that full retirement looks like. And that could be a 10-year picture. So we want people to think about the exit strategy. And that could also mean selling your business at the end of that time, and that could be your full retirement at that point. Identify your goals, security, time, interest with family and friends, understand if you need challenge, recognition, and prestige, because believe it or not, people go into business for those things, and building equity for retirement. So for FranNet, you're wanting to know like how we decide who's going to go into our inventory. Okay, so we have a vetting process, and it, believe it or not, it's the same vetting process that we ask all of our clients to go through. So if they're looking for a franchise, we're actually taking the same exact steps that we would tell our clients to do when somebody wants to come on board with us. So it's a selection process. We do something called the initial stages, where we take a look at the franchise disclosure document. We study it. We make sure that their financials look good. They generally come to us through some sort of referral. Very rarely do we get like the cold, I want to be part of FranNet's inventory, because a lot of times they don't understand that they do have to pay a referral fee when a franchisee buys our business. So we want them to understand what makes us different, why they would want to work with us. So we have to do a little bit of sales on our side as well, but they have to sell us on it. And then we go through something called validation, which every potential franchisee should go through. Validation is when you talk with specific franchisees and get the information from those people. This is where the rubber meets the road. Those people do this business every day. Your first phone call with a franchisor is going to be somebody who wants you to really like their franchise so that you continue on with the process. If you're a good qualified candidate, they want you to really like the franchise. But where you can get the best information is by talking with franchisees. And in the FranNet model, when we start talking with franchisees, we gain a lot of information about what our clients are going to expect when they call franchisees to do their validation. So if the validation's bad, we may not add them to the inventory, because there's no sense in us putting you in front of somebody that has bad validation. That's a big critical factor for us. The validation has to be good, the numbers have to be good, it has to be verifiable, and it doesn't mean that it has to be a long-standing brand with good name recognition. We actually represent some franchises that are new to the market, that are just getting started. They may have 3 to 10 franchises across the United States, but they want to grow, but they better have everything in order and their validation better be good. We'll still represent them, but they have to be able to prove that they can roll it out. And that's why a lot of those younger concepts come to us through some sort of referral process by people who are already in the industry who can help back up that they could be a good risk for us to take on. This slide right here just talks about a few people that are in Colorado that are vets that I've actually put in business recently or within the last 2 years. Take a look at these. I've put people in fitness franchises, outdoor refurbishment. That was a fun one. He's actually doing well. IT services, residential cleaning, kids' hair care. I've got somebody going into a kids' hair care franchise in Colorado Springs, which is kind of fun. And retail computer repair service, kind of like a competitor to Best Buy's Geek Squad. So it's really fun for me to do all of these things, and I especially like it when I can put vets into business, because I do a lot of work with them. So again, feel free to call me if you have any questions. I do have a table out there. I've got some material out there along with books. So thank you all.